We're good to go.
Hi. Okay, welcome back to DrugsCo this week. So last time we did a partial introduction on this lecture, but also I think I've noticed in the past that when I open the chat, you guys can't actually see it on my screen, can you? So if I, can anyone see the chat thing open on my screen right now? Oh, okay, great. Then you guys can continue to message me privately in the chat because I thought everyone could see it and I was just being a giant dick. Okay, excuse me. So last time we talked about, hey y'all. Every time. So last time we went through the first probably quarter of this lecture, but I figured that since I kind of want to get us back on a schedule of doing one lecture per session, which is the idea, although I'm happy to stretch it out, I wanted to restart this so we could actually do a real recap this time of stuff that happened 5 days ago. So let's do that. Let's name neurotransmitters. Just throw them out there. What are the major neurotransmitters? One at a time.
Serotonin.
Serotonin.
Dopamine.
Dopamine. We are
norepinephrine.
Norepinephrine. Thank you. What else? Major neurotransmitters.
GABA.
GABA. Nice. What's the sister to GABA? Also starts with a G.
Glutamate.
Nice, thank you. Almost just didn't put this finger up because I don't know how to count on my hands. And I'm thinking of two more. One starts with a C, one starts with an E. And the one that starts with an E is not quite as relevant here.
Cannabinoids.
Cannabinoids, very nice. And the last one, think of what category of drugs we haven't mentioned in relation to neurotransmitters yet. What are we missing? If you can remember the category, think of what category we're missing right now, then you can say that too. It's a major one. And it's also obvious, it's also obvious enough that I'm not going to move on past this until someone guesses.
Endorphins.
Thank you. Very nice. Okay, great. I love it. Endorphins. Right. So we have dopamine, norepinephrine, GABA, serotonin, glutamate, endorphins, which are the naturally occurring versions of opioids, the endogenous opioids, and cannabinoids. What is the opposite of an agonist?
Antagonist.
Right. Opposite of inhibitory.
Excitatory.
Nice. Opposite of GABA in terms of their function. I have full faith that you guys know this. Opposite of GABA. Think about it. What does GABA do?
Glutamate.
Thank you. Glutamate. So GABA is inhibitory, glutamate is excitatory. They have opposite effects, and we'll talk about that more today. Opposite of endogenous. Something that's endogenous is made inside of the body, so something that's made outside of the body would be called what?
Exogenous.
Exogenous. Nice, thank you. Oops. What kind of glutamate receptor, I didn't emphasize this as much as I usually do, but what kind of glutamate receptor do dissociatives bind to? If any of you remember my song for this, my song that I love that embarrasses everyone semester after semester, because I make you stand up and do it. It's fun to party with. Oh, it's pulling teeth today. There's like one interactive part of this whole lecture, guys. Come on, you can do it.
NMDA.
Thank you. Awesome. The NMDA receptor sounds like MDMA, but it's not. The NMDA receptor is a specific kind of glutamate receptor that dissociatives bind to. That's part of what defines them as being dissociatives, is that they bind at this particular glutamate receptor. receptor, disruptor. What does it mean if something is a serotonin agonist? Five minutes of interactivity in this lecture. We can do it. What does it mean if it's a serotonin agonist?
It increases the effect of serotonin.
Excellent. It increases the effects of serotonin. That's absolutely right. What category of substances increases the effects of GABA? GABA, which slows the system.
Endorphins.
You're on the right track. Endorphins are pertaining to opioids, which technically speaking do sedate the system, but specifically GABA, which is responsible for anti-anxiety, is increased by depressants. So like alcohol and benzos and Robitussin, but that's a very good guess. You're absolutely on the right track. What is it called when you lose oxygen to your extremities? Starts with an H.
Hypoxia.
Nice, hypoxia, that's right. And hypoxia can often come, or not often, but sometimes can come from inhalants or from the side effects of being under the influence of another drug where your respiration has been decreased to the point where you're not getting enough oxygen to your extremities. This is a very good way of identifying a medical emergency, because if someone does not have enough oxygen circulating in their cells, they might have that blue tinting on their nose, their lips, or their fingers. That's a really good way of telling that. So I have inhalants listed here, but this is really just an indicator of some kind of an overdose type situation on drugs that will reduce your body's overall circulation. Skin picking and itching. It starts with a P. Meals. Skin picking and itching. Starts with a P. We can do it. Full faith. PR.
Pruritus.
You're right on the contents. The pronunciation is pruritus, unless I'm actually just stupid, which is possible always, but to my current knowledge, it's pronounced pruritus. But yes, that's correct. So pruritus is skin itching and picking. What two categories of substances might induce skin itchiness or like the urge to pick at skin? Two categories.
Stimulants.
Excellent. And one more.
Opioids.
Nice. Very nice. Okay. What about pain relief? What's the official word for pain relief? Starts with an A.
Analgesia.
Excellent. Analgesia. Nice. Okay. See, I'm very thrilled that people are offering answers because you guys are fucking killing it. So I hope that everyone feels more capable of knowing the right thing right now, because this has been very nice. So analgesia is a very common effect of many different kinds of drugs. It can include depressants or inhalants or dissociatives or opioids, and sometimes a mixture of all those properties are in a particular drug, but pain relief is very common for a lot of these substances. What is the name for the neuron that comes before the synapse? This is a Greek and Latin roots situation. Oh, wait. I mean, so remember that the axon terminal is the foot, basically. It's the top, and the dendrites are at the bottom. Remember, it's foot on fingers, but yes, that's right. So this is the presynaptic neuron. This is not a very clear slide. I need to fix this slide. But the presynaptic neuron is the neuron that's before the next neuron, which means that the next neuron is the postsynaptic neuron. So contained within the axon terminal of the presynaptic neuron, okay, so we have the prior neuron, it's got its foot, and that foot is known as the axon terminal. It contains neurotransmitters inside of it. So electricity comes down, pops these little bubbles, releases neurotransmitter, and what is this space right here called?
Synapse.
Nice. The synapse, exactly. So what are these guys called? These are the locks. Locks that you fit keys inside of.
Receptors?
Nice, receptors. I did not hear the other thing that was said, but whatever it was, I loved hearing it. So this is receptors, right? So we have the presynaptic neuron has an axon terminal that contains neurotransmitters. Electricity pops those bubbles. This is a simplified version, obviously. Pops those bubbles. Neurotransmitters are released into the synapse. They bind at receptors on the postsynaptic neuron, the dendrites of the next neuron. And then electricity either continues through or does not, depending on the neurotransmitter. So for instance, an example of when electricity would not continue is a neurotransmitter such as GABA. So usually something would happen, you know, a different neurotransmitter would bind at a receptor, and then something would happen or a signal would be propagated, would continue through. But with something like GABA, the whole idea is that it's reducing the amount of activity in the brain. It stops the signal from going through as effectively. So keep that in mind. Okay, an agonist, let's remember, is a drug that increases the effects of a neurotransmitter. And this is a specific designation of just kind of broadly saying that it increases the effects of a neurotransmitter because there are multiple ways that that can happen. And the same with an antagonist. Remember, an antagonist decreases the effects of a neurotransmitter. So we'll go right now into how an agonist might increase or an antagonist might decrease. Okay, so some ways that an agonist might increase the effects of a neurotransmitter might be through mimicry, which is fitting into and activating a receptor by basically disguising itself as a neurotransmitter, by coming in with its freaking costume on. I had a metaphor there, but it just vanished. Coming in and pretending that it looks like a neurotransmitter so it can pop itself in the receptor and do that neurotransmitter's job. So for instance, if you have like, let's say you have 15 serotonin molecules and you introduce something like, actually this is too complicated of an example, pretend I didn't say anything, but the gist is that it can either pretend to be an existing neurotransmitter or it can stimulate the release or production of that neurotransmitter, thereby having more of that neurotransmitter available to do its thing, or it can do what's called reuptake inhibition. And we're gonna come back to this later today and talk about what reuptake inhibition is and why it's relevant. Antagonists, on the other hand, can function in a couple different ways. The first by blocking a receptor, so it prevents neurotransmitters from binding at that receptor and doing their thing. Or it can decrease the production of that neurotransmitter, so there's less of that neurotransmitter being made and therefore less of it available to do its thing. Or it can increase reuptake. And again, we'll come back to what reuptake is in a little bit today. So a quick refresher on inhibition and excitation. So an inhibitory neurotransmitter is something that basically reduces the amount of signaling in the brain, calms the brain, basically. Whereas an excitatory neurotransmitter excites, obviously, the brain. So it increases the signaling strength, basically. It increases the frequency of signaling. So an example of an inhibitory neurotransmitter would be GABA, right? Because GABA reduces the amount of signaling in the brain. It's like, calm down, we don't need to be active, we don't need to be anxious. Whereas glutamate might increase the amount of signaling in the brain and therefore increase the amount of connectivity and activity happening in the brain. So inhibition is going to slow or stop the signaling, whereas excitation will facilitate the signaling. And that's why excitatory neurotransmitters, or specifically the excitatory neurotransmitter glutamate, is important for learning and memory, because glutamate basically allows your brain to fire more effectively and connect with itself. And GABA is important for anti-anxiety because it prevents your brain from just being like, about one thing or another, right? Which is why benzos are effective at treating anxiety attacks, is because they prevent your brain from just like firing like crazy about stuff. Any questions on that? I know it's a little bit weird. To be clear, agonist versus antagonist pertains to something that you put into your body to influence your existing neurotransmitters. Inhibitory versus excitatory refers to the difference between glutamate and GABA, right? So GABA calms down your brain signaling, glutamate increases your brain signaling. Let me know if you guys have questions on that. I know it's kind of a weird distinction to make. Okay, so remember, agonist increases the effects of a neurotransmitter, right? So is GABA What am I trying to say here? Oh yeah, GABA's inhibitory. I looked at this beforehand and was like, I'm going to forget what this slide is supposed to say. And lo and behold, here we are. There are but a few constants in the universe, and one of them is that I forget everything. GABA's inhibitory effects are increased by an agonist. Okay, so if we have a GABA agonist, that means that there's more of the effects of GABA. GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. So if we increase the effects of an inhibitory neurotransmitter, we're increasing the amount of inhibition in the brain. Okay, so we are increasing the amount of calm in the brain with a GABA agonist. So an example of this, again, would be a depressant. And I know we've already been over this last time, so bear with me. I just want to make sure we got an actual recap. So dopamine is responsible for regulating what two things? I lied, there's more interactivity today. Sorry. What two things does dopamine regulate? Starts with an R?
Reward.
Reward, excellent. What else? You can think about what might happen from high chronic doses of a drug like methamphetamine. Think about what kind of symptoms the body might exhibit.
Tremor. Muscle control?
Motor control. That's very close, yeah. Motor control. Basically the same thing. A dopamine agonist increases or decreases the effects of dopamine.
Increases.
Nice. So what would that make the person feel if they had a dopamine agonist in their system, increasing the effects of dopamine?
Dope.
Yeah. Would make a person feel more rewarded about doing whatever it was that they were doing. And in some cases might actually improve their ability to retain muscle tone, which is why I've mentioned this last time, why Adderall has actually been banned in Major League Baseball for this reason. So an example of a dopamine agonist would be what? A specific drug.
Sorry, Rachel, did you just say that Adderall makes you more buff?
That Adderall makes you more buff?
Is that what you just said?
Well, the truth of it is that there is some evidence saying that amphetamine can improve muscle tone during exercise. There isn't a lot of hard data that I'm aware of that supports the dose and consistency that could be done safely with Adderall to improve muscle tone and retention. However, yeah, it's totally true that it does indeed make you a little bit more effective during workouts. And the other problem here, though, is that since it's also a stimulant, it can have negative influence over your cardiovascular system at the same time. Also, I do not think, in answer to your question, that the term dope evolved from the word dopamine. I think that I actually have no idea what the origin of it was, but I don't think it was dopamine. But maybe I'm wrong, actually. Who knows? If anyone can contradict that, let me know. It's an interesting question. So an example, okay, I put meth here, but like amphetamine is also a dopamine agonist because it increases the effects of dopamine. But yeah, in regards to amphetamine / Adderall in sports, we'll come back to that during the stimulant spotlight next week or 2 weeks from now, talking about Major League Baseball and how greenies are what amphetamine is known as in those circuits because it's a performance enhancing drug. Okay,
Would LSD also be considered a dopamine agonist because it increases the effects of dopamine, or no?
LSD, in a very, very, very minor sense, may act on dopamine, but not in a substantial one. LSD and other primary or classical psychedelics actually mostly act on serotonin. And that's interesting, right? Because so the distinction to be made here is that dopamine is a heavy influencer of reward, like feeling rewarded, whereas serotonin is a heavy influencer of your mood overall, like your acquisition and sensation of pleasure, but also your perception of the world around you. So that's part of why LSD, and again, we'll come back to this, LSD does not really exert massive effects on dopamine. It's really mainly about serotonin. When I was first getting into drug education, I also was like, oh yeah, totally. Of course, psychedelics act on dopamine. That just makes the most sense. But then it's not a serotonin. So dopamine agonists, stimulants, generally speaking. Stimulants will make you feel rewarded about whatever it is that you're doing, or anxious, depending on who you are and what your dose is. It really depends. I'm looking at the definition of dope. Sauce, gravy, any thick liquid. From Dutch dupe, thick dipping sauce from dupe into dip, LOL. That really just felt like I was reading a full-blown alien language out loud. So a psychoactive, for our intents and purposes, is a substance that, when ingested, affects your mental processes. Okay, so if something is psychoactive, it affects how you think and perceive effectively. Another word for this is a psychopharmaceutical, although this is usually reserved for drugs that are technically prescribed, or a psychotropic. So these are all words that kind of mean a similar thing in that they affect your psyche as well as your body. Let's look really briefly at some major drug interactions, then we will come back for each of these categories and go more into detail. Trypsin has an awesome, possibly, I see you, Duchess, an awesome, possibly a little bit intimidating chart on drug combinations. And this is a really important reflection of how easy it is to accidentally combine things that can be potentially dangerous. So just like one arbitrary, I don't know, example is this entire quadrant over here. That basically will be a pretty easy indicator of which general categories of drugs, because you can see that these drugs are organized by category-ish across the top, generally tend to have more problematic interactions with each other. So for instance, alcohol, GHB, GBL, opioids, tramadol, benzos, those are all examples of depressants and opioids, which both have the potential to reduce your heart rate and your blood pressure, and thereby reduce your breathing. So if you look at something like, it's interesting, if you look at ketamine over here, remember how I mentioned that ketamine is one of the only dissociatives that doesn't substantially depress your breathing and your heart rate. So that's why ketamine is not known to have a particularly, that's weed. Interesting. Okay. I take that back. I was like, oh yeah, totally. But that's weed, not ketamine. Someone fire me. All right. So I take that all back. Yeah. You should definitely not combine ketamine and alcohol. I'll just tell you that right off the bat. You combine ketamine and alcohol, you're puking red wine in the parking lot and someone's employee is coming to pick you up and get you an Uber home. You don't want that. It's embarrassing. Gets your shoes all wet and with your own puke. It's gross. We don't like it. So I highly advise looking at any kind of interaction chart before doing any drugs, especially if you're on medications, because a lot of the time I'm looking at the chat now to see if anyone was like, you dumb bitch. Oh no, you guys are still talking about dope. I was expecting it to be a bunch of people being like, boo, get a degree. So especially with medications, people don't realize that so many things interact with each other. Fun fact, grapefruit interacts with so many medications and drugs. You would never know that though, right? But grapefruit really does put you at risk of interaction for many substances that are serotonin agonists and other kinds of agonists. With a huge percentage of the population on antidepressants and SSRIs, what drugs are to be avoided? I'm not going to go into that directly right now because it's a big conversation and we'll have it later in the course, but generally speaking, if you are on SSRIs, which yes, a huge percentage of the population is on, you're going to want to avoid drugs that act on serotonin in some way. Oftentimes with something like, for instance, combining an SSRI with Molly, you're just not going to roll, but the MDMA in your system might still cause strain on your system. So people end up taking a shitload more just to break that fourth wall and get through and start rolling because they're like, oh, I can take like 800 milligrams of Molly because I'm on SSRIs or otherwise I won't feel it. But you're still taking 800 milligrams of Molly, which really puts you at high risk of serotonin syndrome for that reason alone. So we'll come back to that. That's a really good question. I do want to point out here that MAOIs and SSRIs have their own interactions, like I just mentioned, so I'm glad that you brought that up, especially with serotonin acting. You know, I just have some beef with parts of this chart, actually. I'm gonna look at this chart more carefully before I recommend it. So basic interactions, though, in terms of depressants and depressant, something like Xanax, which is a benzo, both of these things are going to increase GABA, right? Alcohol, Xanax, both will increase GABA in your system, which will lower the speed of your system, which will drastically lower the speed of your system, which means that you're going to have a really severely decreased heart rate and blood pressure. So depressants and depressants don't mix safely at all. And that's part of why, especially, we've seen a lot of party-related casualties from people that are drinking and then they take bars, or they're drinking and they have like some kind of other depressant they combine with. And because of that, that's how they end up like choking on their own puke and asphyxiating, which is really upsetting, obviously. When it comes to depressants and opioids, it's a similar kind of situation. Both of these drugs will reduce your heart rate and blood pressure, and because of that, you have drastically decreased heart rate and blood pressure. These things compound each other. So it's very important to, the grapefruit thing, we'll come back to grapefruit a little bit later in the semester because there's a lot to say on that one. It interacts with a lot of stuff. And part of that is because there's actually an enzyme in your liver that is supposed to break down a lot of different kinds of medications. And grapefruit and other kinds of citrus fruits prevent that enzyme from doing its job. So you just have an excess buildup of the medication. It doesn't get broken down effectively. And then you have negative side effects, or your medication's strength is greatly increased. So that's why you always have to check interactions with everything. Like, everything has an interaction. If you ever combined like Aleve and ibuprofen, they have an interaction. They're both NSAIDs. You risk like stomach bleeding. Tripsit did update this recently, and I need to fix that. So thanks for pointing that out. So depressants and dissociatives, this is another kind of tricky one because generally speaking, while it depends on the dissociative involved, remember that depressants are going to increase the effects of GABA, which will slow down your system. Dissociatives, we're going to decrease the effects of glutamate, which will also slow down your system and adjust your perception. And because of that, again, you do run the risk of having decreased heart rate and blood pressure. Depressants and stimulants is kind of a weird one though, right? So alcohol or other depressants are going to increase the effects of GABA, slows down your system. Then you might have something like Coke, which is going to increase the effects of norepinephrine, speeds up your system. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a lot of speculation on this because at some lower doses, oftentimes this isn't a particularly dangerous combination, but think about the amount of confusion in your bod if you're putting a combination of a stimulant and a depressant into it. Like, does your heart rate go up or down? Are you feeling more alert or less alert? And because of this, it really is a more dose and substance dependent situation, whether or not it's a dangerous combination, but generally speaking, start low and go slow. It's very common and very popular to combine Adderall and alcohol, for instance, as a party combination. But because of this, people might end up being stimulated to the point where they don't realize how drunk they are or how barred out they are or whatever, which causes them to come down off of the stimulant and be like, fuck, oh, I am trashed. So another thing I want to point out here, and this is something that is really important to keep in mind, is that it's not always directly the effects of combining those two drugs from like an experiential level, like how it makes you feel. In some cases, with something like alcohol and Coke, when they are metabolized in your liver, they become what's called cocaethylene. And cocaethylene is toxic. It's the metabolization of these two things together. So sometimes it's not necessarily about how you feel in the moment. It's not about, oh, these drugs will make you feel shitty. It's that when they interact in your body, they could produce a third party, basically, that causes toxicity and causes damage. So again, always check your interactions. Always check your interactions. There's almost always some kind of interaction between drugs. So let's go back to reuptake. Let's talk about reuptake because I've mentioned it a couple times now. So we can think of an SSRI, right? An SSRI, I'm sure most or all of us in this building are familiar with SSRIs, which is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. And we'll break that down on the next slide. But for now, I want to look at the process of reuptake and what that entails. So reuptake basically is you start out with your neurotransmitters, right? There's a signal, boop, boop, they get released in the synapse. They do their thing. They bind to the receptors. Everyone cheers. There's a homecoming parade. People dress up. There's a drag show maybe. It's just such a good time. We love neurotransmitters. But then when they're done binding at the receptors, right? When they've done their thing, they've like fucked the cult, the, I tried to say key and hole and just, whatever. They fucked the keyhole. And then they were like, boop, I've done my thing. The electricity's continued. Everyone stopped looking at me like I'm saying a bunch of shit that doesn't make sense. I'm sorry. But then what? You know, they're just floating around in the synapse. Eventually, they're going to get sucked back up by these guys called transporters. These are like the little vacuums that are like, okay, you guys have had your fun. You've been released. You've bound at the receptors. We're just going to suck you back up and repackage you into these little vesicles, these bubbles, so we can use you again. It's basically recycling. That's what reuptake is. If you inhibit reuptake, if you inhibit reuptake, then instead of all these neurotransmitters getting sucked back up to get repackaged, they're going to stick around in the synapse and bind repeatedly. So it's basically like more bang for your buck. That's how you think about it in terms of reuptake. If you have more neurotransmitters that are available to bind at receptors and continue a signal, then you're going to have more of that neurotransmitter's action. So this is one of the ways that a drug might be an agonist, is if you have, for instance, a serotonin agonist that acts on, or that exerts its function as an agonist by reuptake inhibition. It means that it's furthering how far one neurotransmitter can go by keeping it stuck in the synapse to bind over and over again before it gets sucked back up. So basically, you might have an SSRI plug itself up in these transporters so that nothing can get back in here, basically. Does that make sense? Does anyone have questions on that? I see some like moderate agreement. Not full convincing. We'll revisit this topic a couple times. What you need to take away from this is knowing that a reuptake inhibitor gives you more bang for your buck for existing neurotransmitters in the synapse. Once they've been released, they stay there longer. They do their thing more. They make you feel more of whatever that neurotransmitter does. So if you have a serotonin reuptake inhibitor, you're going to feel more of that serotonin effect because there's more of that serotonin available to bind at receptors and keep the signal going. Okay? So if we break down... Yes.
Do the serotonin or other neurotransmitters, do they like decay over use? Like, or can you just like keep them binding?
So
like definitely.
Generally speaking, there will be kind of cleanup agents that come in. That's actually where MAO comes into play, monoamine oxidase. And that's where we see another kind of antidepressant, an MAOI, which inhibits the job of MAO, which is a different kind of cleanup mechanism. And the gist of it is, once there's a neurotransmitter that's been hanging out in the synapse for long enough, it might get gobbled up by one of these cleanup guys. So there are two ways, or there are multiple ways.
Regardless of the reuptake mechanism.
Yeah. Right. So either it gets sucked back up and recycled, or it gets gobbled up by MAO and destroyed. So it's really kind of whichever happens first. And that's why if you combine an MAOI with an SSRI, then you have a lot of serotonin in the synapse, and you don't have anything in there going and eating it to clean it up. So that gives you the risk of serotonin syndrome, which is a very uncomfortable, potentially dangerous situation where you have too much serotonin activity in your brain. And we'll come back to that.
Not just an easy 24-hour roll.
Sorry? No, not just an easy 24-hour roll. That would really cheapen the price of pressies, though. So let's break down an SSRI, right? So selective is the first S, which means that it's a particular kind of serotonin receptors. Remember that each of the neurotransmitters has a couple variations of serotonin receptor or of receptors that do slightly different things within their wheelhouse. So if you go to Wikipedia for something like MDMA, you'll see that it has a high affinity, or not MDMA, for LSD, you'll see that it has a high affinity for the 5-HT2A receptor, which sounds terrifying, but it's just a specific kind of serotonin receptor. So if you go to a page and see, oh, this is a 5-HT2A receptor agonist, you know, oh, that's a serotonin agonist, and specifically, that's a psychedelic serotonin agonist with limitations. You know, that's a general thing to say. Then the next S is for serotonin. Then there's reuptake and inhibition. So it's acting on a specific kind of serotonin receptor. It's preventing serotonin from getting sucked up and recycled, and therefore, it's increasing the effectiveness of serotonin in the brain. And we'll go into exactly how SSRIs are thought to work because it's not that simple, but just for now, that's how generally reuptake can be envisioned. All right, let's talk about legality. This is not my favorite topic because it's like really hard to keep track of what's happening with drugs all over the world. So I'm just gonna touch briefly on a whole bunch of different shit and get this out of the way for next time when we can hopefully start on psychedelics, which I'm very excited about. Okay. So there are a couple of countries around the world that have capital punishment execution, basically, for drug laws. And the United States is sometimes one of those countries. Some countries enforce this more militantly than others. The United States tends to be a little bit more like, you know, we as a country have this tendency to be like, we're posh, and then do all the same shit, but it looks a little better on paper to the average American citizen who's like condoning death to drug dealers under the guise of liberty or whatever, but we won't get into that. So on the other side of the coin, we have countries that have decriminalized drugs, which basically means that they're not legal necessarily. Like, decrim does not mean legal. It instead means that you're just not going to get pursued for having drugs, basically. So that's what's happened in Denver, for instance, where magic mushrooms have been decriminalized. It means that they're the lowest priority on law enforcement's radar, in theory. You know, it's like, only time will tell if they actually follow that model. But that means that in these countries, they've just made it a really low priority to punish and pursue people for possessing and using drugs. Now, the whole world is governed by three main, oh my God, I'm bathed in this like horrifying red light. The whole world has basically been governed by three major treaties. And if you're anything like me, you hear the word treaty and you instantly fall asleep and your brain blows up. So forgive me, I'm going to try and make this as not painful as possible because this is actually really important right now. And I personally always underestimated how important it is to look at law, because law tells you so much about how people justify their shitty actions, right? Really easy to write a law to benefit your country and yourself and your own interests. So we start out in 1961 with the Single Convention on Narcotic Drugs. This is often just known as the Single Convention. And this convention was basically a bunch of people that got together after many, many years of studying drug use across the world. And they basically were like, okay, like each of these countries, tell us what your relationship is with drugs and tell us how we want to like internationally organize around them. And this got split up into caucuses. It got split up into basically five different sections of countries that had different relationships with drugs. So for instance, countries like, or like even mostly continents in some cases, but I'd say, I'm trying to think of countries off the top of my head, like countries like Brazil, I believe, and a lot of South American countries that have, like Peru in particular, that grow coca crops, where coca is a really prominent social and cultural and historical part of their country, were basically like, okay, we don't want to have a lot of international regulation on like crop growing, because that's just like, you know, it doesn't really do anything bad to us. Like, we're just growing this crop. Meanwhile, in the United States, they were like, okay, we should criminalize all the people that are growing shit, but we should not criminalize people that are synthesizing stuff in labs, because that's kind of, you know, what we're doing right now, and we need to protect our own interests. So this ended up being a compromise that was attempted to be made between all these countries that were basically like, okay, what does my economy rely on? What does my culture rely on? And there's a huge split there, right? Because obviously the countries that have a lot of production of drug crops, but they're just crops that happen to be made into drugs, we're like, yo, our GDP really is kind of reliant on this. So initially the Single Convention was basically like finding ways to help countries, establishing ways for countries to communicate with each other about what they could and could not produce and import and export, basically. That was the first thing that they did. And they were addressing morphine-like drugs, cocaine-like drugs, and cannabis-like drugs. And there's a reason that those three specific categories were brought up in this convention. We'll come back to that in a little bit. Then later we have 1971, the Convention on Psychotropic Substances. And this was basically, they're like, oh fuck, there's like a whole bunch of drugs that were not in the original convention. We gotta put those in there. So they made stock images like this one, which was a huge mistake, and everyone's regretted it ever since then. And this next convention included amphetamine type stimulants, benzos and barbiturates, and psychedelics. So those are the three new major categories. And this one was basically just like, all right, you know, we left a couple things out and now it's getting popularized by the hippies and whatever the fuck else. And so we're just gonna stick it in there and now we have new legislature, that's good. And then they reconvened to have this absolutely ridiculously named convention This, I'm so proud of this meme, and no one ever thinks it's as funny as I do. I swear to God, I sat at my desk just like laughing maniacally for about 20 minutes the first time I made it. I was like, this is absolute peak humor. The United Nations Convention Against Illicit Traffic in Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances. You know, if I look back on it, it's not like the name is that long, but I really feel like they could have done any work to shorten it. You know, like throw us a bone here, okay? And this one was like fine-tuning the international cooperation on like trying to stop drugs from doing their thing. So this one was basically like, okay, we're going to also look at the precursors to drugs, like the ingredients that you need to make drugs. We're going to also regulate that because that's a loophole. You know, previously people could just like import the ingredients and make them DIY, bitch. And then dealer shutdown, trying to coordinate internationally about reducing the amount of drugs that people could bring in and out of their countries. And then also going to the countries and being like, all right, y'all need to make your own laws on how to criminalized possession, basically. So this was kind of like, we want to shut down organized crime now, because what happened in the first two conventions is they were like, you know, you can't like import and export this thing, and you got to be careful when you eat this thing. And they didn't really give countries any specific instruction of like, here's how you enforce this. They were just like, yeah, you got to make your own drug laws. But this time they were like, oh, people were actually getting kind of wise, and they were like, just making the drugs themselves. They were like, oh, you got some, let me think of a good precursor. You got some safrole in Cambodia. We'll just import some safrole and make Molly on our own turf. Like, that just works for us because you can't export Molly, but we can just fucking make it ourselves. You know, like, this is America. We do whatever. Now, in these conventions, the parties involved in them can define their own laws and choose how to enforce them. And different countries do that differently. So in Indonesia, this is inside of their airport entrance, or at least it was at the time of this photo. I need to date check this. Welcome to Indonesia, death penalty for drug traffickers is in the airport. Versus the Netherlands, which is like, here's the different kinds of magic mushrooms you can buy at our store today. And then in Iran, a couple of years ago, there was kind of like a quiet rollback of capital punishment. And just to be clear, someone asked me last semester, and I needed to go in and check this, whether or not this image was actually from a public hanging of drug possession or dealing. And I believe that it was pulled from an article on the subject, but I need to check the source on whether or not it actually was from that event. So this map, terrifying, definitely. So hot in here. Oh my God, it's like 90 degrees out. Ohio, man. The drug trafficking routes that different substances take are so complex. But you can see kind of general patterns, general trends for how that can happen. So I'm not going to go deep into this map right now, but I encourage you to come back to these lectures and zoom in on this and look. So we'll go over some of the minor stuff. And you will start to see that there are different regions, different continents in particular, that tend to produce a certain kind of drug. So for instance, South America tends to produce and export certain kinds of stimulants. And part of this is because of the crops that grow in certain regions of South America. And part of this is because of their proximity to the United States and the availability of the resources that are needed to make things like methamphetamine, which the United States imports from neighboring countries. Then in other areas, you have things like amphetamine, which are, actually I won't get into that now. Then the Middle East and also Southeast Asia are massive predominant producers of opium and other derivatives that create opioids. So stimulants, naturally occurring stimulants, there's so many drugs that are contained in plants, you guys. In case you weren't aware of this, like, fuck, if you walk down the side of the highway and you pick a plant and you're like, I wonder if I get high if I ate this, the answer is probably no. But there are some plants where you will get high. So some of them include, in terms of stimulants, things like, let me see which we're going to talk about in here, khat in East Africa, the betel nut in Southeast Asia, kratom, and other kinds of naturally occurring plants. So khat in Ethiopia is a naturally occurring stimulant containing the plant. The kola nut is in Nigeria. And we're not going to get super in depth on a lot of these because we just don't have time. But let's take a look real quick at non-naturally occurring stimulant, which is meth. Whoops, or not. Does that every single time. This is from a documentary that I consider to be one of my favorite documentaries of all time. It's called Cartel Land. It was on Netflix. I don't know if it ever will be again. If there's any one drug documentary that I've seen that I recommend you watching, it's this one. It is very upsetting. very worth watching and really paints a picture of how complicated the situation in Mexico is right now.
El lugar donde más drogas se venden es Estados Unidos. Todos Estados Unidos. Pues, ¿qué te voy a decir? Claro que hacemos daño, ¿eh? Lo sabemos. Toda droga que se va para allá. Pero te vuelvo a decir, tenemos de bajo recursos, estamos pobres. Porque si estuviéramos bien, anduviéramos como ustedes, viajando por todo el mundo, países o X, haciendo trabajos limpios, buenos como ustedes. Y si nos vamos a poner a ver qué, a ver, para que el corazoncito se nos doble, pues vamos a atar de perros, apá. Pues nomás la voy a hacer hasta que Dios quiera. Hasta que Dios quiera, hasta ahí vamos a dejar de hacer droga.
I cannot stress to you how complicated this is. And we're going to go into it with as much detail as I can within the span of a single course, but I could teach an entire course just on the cartel situation and drug violence in Mexico and the causes of it. Let me be perfectly clear. The United States is the root of all drug problems in general. I just want to make that clear. We are the drivers of this force. We are the perpetuators of this system. And while there are many other problems that have arisen elsewhere, we are the ones that allow them to continue happening. So do not let your attention be diverted to the fact that Mexico is producing drugs right now. That is not Mexico's fault. Do not be diverted by that. Be careful. That is what creates xenophobia. So in terms of amphetamine production and manufacture, again, Mexico is a major production center, as well as sections of Southwest Canada. Europe is a huge hub of amphetamine in particular. Sorry, this is methamphetamine. So Western Hemisphere is much more involved in methamphetamine production and movement, as well as regions of Southeast Asia and Australia. But Europe is really into amphetamine, which is the effectively the primary active ingredient. Yes, Canada. I see you, Laurie. So Canada is a major producer of many illicit substances because they have much looser drug regulation and they're right next to the United States border. So the fact that the US does not have a legal regulated market or even DCRIM means that we're outsourcing all of our drugs. And the two nearest countries are going to have the easiest time getting us those drugs with the lowest drop in profit because you don't have to have money changing hands through an entire supply chain that crosses the ocean. It's much easier to just bribe someone that's part of the US military, which we'll get to in a second. So in terms of cocaine in particular, this is a massive issue. The coke trade I mentioned last time was bloody, and I do want to clarify. Someone pointed out a very good point about me mentioning that the coke trade was bloody. I think that I might have misspoken and said that the production is bloody. And well, in some ways, I would say most drug production has the potential to be bloody. What I'm specifically referring to is the political systems that have arisen from the passage of coke from hand to hand to hand. And the fact that there are entire civil wars being fought over the control of the coke trade, because where there's coke, there's money. And where there's money, there are arms. We'll come back to that. So I do want to point out that coke is a major positive cultural, social, edible plant, or the coca plant, in many countries in South America. And it has not, it's just not been interpreted and utilized in the same way that it has in countries that are using it for party purposes. So again, we'll come back to that. But I do want to emphasize that and thank the person that brought that up to my attention. And North America is a major consumer. North America, Europe, and Australia. We'll see that in all these maps. Those are the three regions that consume the most party drugs. North America, Europe, and Australia. Let's see what the United States Border Patrol has to say about this.
Have you ever crossed from Tijuana into San Diego?
Well, I have.
This is an interview with a major coke trafficker.
Indeed. The chief of police of Tijuana was my friend. And we used to sit at the bar in Tijuana and get totally lambasted. And we'd snort coke all night. And when we'd run out of coke, he'd send one of his bodyguard cops. He'd go call them over and say, go back to the station and get some coke. And they'd go back to the station and get into the locker and take out a bag of coke and bring it to us in the bar. You know, that's how it worked in Mexico. It took money.
Do you think you'd be able to successfully bring drugs from Tijuana into San Diego today?
If I wanted to, of course.
So a lot of this requires participation from U.S. Border Patrol agents and U.S. military. And we're going to see that in Myanmar and other countries where we have a large military presence that's been, like, at least in the region. That U.S. military is a huge movement point for drugs. And again, let's just look at this map and look at how North America, Europe, Russia, and this as well, and Australia are the primary hotspots for party drugs. Like, we are the consumer of party drugs. Like, yes, Europe goes balls to the wall, and Australia does too in a lot of ways, but, like, also important to note that the predominantly white regions of the world have the highest rates of consumption of drugs in general. So MDMA, we're going to get back into this because this is actually an environmental hotbed of problems. The Anglosphere, exactly. So this is just like a quick delve into that because I want you guys to have kind of a little bit of an understanding of just how far out this web of intersectionality goes. Cambodian sassafras trees. Sassafras trees that grow in the Cardamom rainforest of Cambodia were previously the only source of the precursor for ecstasy. And this required, and these are very, very protected, endangered trees in a very protected, endangered rainforest situation. What's the word I'm looking for? Biosphere, you know what I mean? Thing. And because of this, this caused mass deforestation of sassafras trees. And since then, since approximately 2014, we've finally found a chemical precursor called PMK glycidate that can be used to make Molly without cutting down sassafras trees. But prior to that, and even to this day, there is massive poaching happening in these protected rainforests to make Molly. Now, depressants, again, are, I would say, even more prevalently found in plants and other similar things. I'm reading Diego's comment. Yes, absolutely. Coca plants can be chewed. The coca leaf can be chewed and pressed up against the gum because that's a kind of absorption because your blood vessels are right next to the surface of your gum. So it's a very commonly used stimulant. And coca tea is brewed in many regions of South America. And it's just a totally different experience than Americans doing coke at a bar. It's just like a very, very different thing. So something that we'll see. And if you guys are curious about peyote, let me know and I can do kind of like a side discussion about peyote at some point in the future and go further into it because the social political constructs behind peyote are way complicated and a really good example of how white people will look at a naturally occurring psychoactive substance and will be like, you're dirty for using it. Often in those exact words. And then if they find a way to synthesize it in a lab and make it look like a not plant, they'll be like, okay, this is science. This is fine. And peyote is a prime example of that. Once Europeans and Americans, white Americans, could extract mescaline and use that in a therapeutic and scientific context, they were like, oh, mescaline's chill, but natives and Mexicans are dirty for eating the actual cactus. It makes you depraved. So we'll come back to that. Oh man, I just like cannot get off topic right now.
Isn't peyote like allowed in religious ceremonies across the United States?
In the Native American church. And interestingly, I'm gonna have to work really hard not to get sidetracked right now, but I know it's so hard. The Native American church was actually established in response to the United States government attempting to assimilate and whitewash Native populations because Native populations in the Southwest United States regions, especially like close to Northern Mexico, were utilizing peyote, not extensively actually. It wasn't really a huge thing, but it was basically their way of being like, you're taking so much from us right now that we're going to establish this as something that we need to protect for ourselves. And it became more of an important thing as part of Native and Indigenous populations as they developed the Native American church. And it's become a real problem because white Americans have tried to use that and be like, oh, I'm part of the Native American church. I'm allowed to do this, in response to them getting caught. Classic white people. So we'll do a whole roundtable on peyote. We should do it after the psychedelics discussion because it's complex in a couple of weeks, maybe. So I'll put another message about that. We only have a couple more minutes. God, I'm behind on everything. So naturally occurring depressants include things like even cloves and juniper. Cloves will numb you as well. If anyone's ever, as a kid, like made spice mixtures with the spice cabinet and like eaten some cloves and been like, I can't talk, it's because you're numbing yourself by accident. Then there are other naturally occurring depressants, like even sugarcane is a naturally occurring depressant, and agave, which is in Mexico, and barley, and like all kinds of shit just grows naturally, including things like kava in the Pacific Islands, which we'll come back to again, and absinthe, which is just like, you know, it's kind of like a Swiss deal or something. I don't really know shit about absinthe, but it's in here because it's green, and that cup is just gorgeous. So currently, one of the primary like controlled depressants in the United States is the class of benzos. And this is sweeping the nation right now as kind of an undercover crisis that we're not having a lot of discussion about, which is a pretty big problem. Alcohol also is extremely, extremely prevalent in Australia and Russia and also in regions of North America and also obviously in Europe. But benzos are something that's really interesting that we're gonna spend a little bit of time on because they're very covert compared to alcohol, but they're causing quite a bit of disruption in communities that are using them without understanding their risks. So just for a little bit of comparison, many countries in Europe are very, very heavy consumers of alcohol, and we're not really gonna talk about alcohol in this class because there's enough information that's easily accessible about it, but I figured I would throw this in there anyway. Now, let's instead take a look at Valium. In Britain. Also, I just want to say that if you're ever looking to watch some drug media, I have to plug Vice as being, in my opinion, unequivocally the best video documenting service for real shit about drugs right now. Like, if you want to learn about drugs and actually see things, watch Vice documentaries. They are so good. About other things, I reserve judgment on Vice, but in terms of drugs specifically, they're some of the few publications that are actually going to the communities in question, asking the right things, and participating in appropriate ways.
When I stepped off the airport, I was doing any Valium. When I first started taking Valium, I used to take them out in the street, and then I'd end up one thing that would be the airport shoplifting and stuff. Whereas now, I come back, I come to the house, I'll sit, I'll shut the door, and that's me. I do it the proper way. Whereas people do it the wrong way by just going around the town full of it, pinching things and that. Well, I don't do that. I'm a beggar. Sitting there begging, actually, this could be a nice feeling. You sat there, you're not harming anybody, so they wouldn't help you.
When did you first take Valium?
When I was about 13 years old. Because I was younger, I might have been only 11.
How old are you now?
I'm 29.
Would you usually take 30, 40 Valium as well as smoking legal highs and taking methadone? Okay. That's not unusual. Like many users, Levi was taking Valium with a combination of other drugs. This can be particularly dangerous, and the effects were really starting to show.
All right, that's all that we'll do for today. As usual, I did not get all the way through the lecture. Man, that was never happened, maybe. So we'll revisit the peyote roundtable a little bit later. For now, I do want us to get to the point in the course where we have enough background to have a real informed discussion about it, but we'll do some spotlights on that because I think that'd be nice. In the meantime, I will see you guys on Thursday. We'll finish up this lecture and hopefully be able to start on psychedelics. Thank you so much for tuning in to this week's episode of DrugsCo. And have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel.
Rachel, have you watched Pharmacopoeia with Vice?
I love Pharmacopoeia. A friend of mine is Matt Hamilton, and he's
great
just
show.
Weird.
Matt Hamilton?
Not me, but a friend of mine is Matt Hamilton, and apparently he's just as weird as you would expect. Yeah, good guy, though. Also, Ray, you can stop recording.
I thought I had to live my life.
Great day to Rachel.